Gayatri Nair. She's an assistant professor at the Tata Institute of Social Sciences. She did a PhD at JNU and taught in Delhi University and symbiosis, and right now she's at TISC. So please welcome her with a round of applause. She's talking on a very pertinent issue, and hopefully you all will learn more about it. So about 5 minutes?
Hi everyone, thank you to Lavanya and thank you to the Department of HSS for this opportunity to speak to all of you. You know, Lavanya did say this is a pertinent issue. I hope that I can lay the case out for why it is a pertinent issue. And I've slightly sort of altered the title of this talk, but basically what this presentation is, it comes from a paper, this is drawn from my doctoral research as well, is to basically focus on the question of the labor movement that was emerging within the fisheries in Mumbai and the need to sort of rethink, look at movements that are playing out on the ground to try and understand how we might better sort of formulate policy around questions of common resources on which livelihoods are based, and to also complicate this question a little bit, because essentially the common that I was looking at was the seas, and I was looking at a fishing community that was dependent on this in the city of Mumbai. So what might have the context of that urban space done to this entire question of the the notion of accessing your common accessing rights to your common resources, accessing rights to the city itself, and what therefore the policy should actually look like. Because when the policy is being formulated, it's being formulated in general for the country as a whole. And what might be the specificities that we actually need to pay attention to as they emerge in these different kinds of locations is something that I'm trying to focus on. And an important part that emerged from this work, I think, was the question of what was happening with women's labor. And what I thought was personally very interesting at that point for me was that when I went out into the field and when I was doing this research, what emerged was that women were at the forefront of these struggles, were at the forefront of these conversations, and participating most publicly in this. So what drove this, the interest in this particular paper that I'm presenting here, is to try and understand why was it that these women were at the forefront in this kind of thing. What was the sort of context from which they were emerging, how were they responding to the changes that had taken place, was something that I sought to understand, and I can hopefully present this argument to you today. So let's just begin by first looking at who the Kolis are. So the Koli community is a fishing community that is based in Mumbai in particular. There's the Koli caste as a whole has two sort of sub-castes. There's the stone Kolis, which are the fishing community, and then you have the agrarian caste, which are the Mahavir Kolis. But what is of interest to us is that if you were to pick up any kind of book on the history of the islands of Bombay and Mumbai as it is known today, it would be virtually impossible for you to, it would not be possible for you to not encounter the figure of the Koli. Right? Like, there is no history of Bombay without looking at who the Kolis were, and in that sense, they have within both a popular discourse as well as within the anthropological attention that has come to this community, they have been regarded as what we would call the indigenous community or the original inhabitants of these islands, right? And therefore, their place within the history of Bombay, within the politics and the social context of Bombay, is fairly well recognized. And yet, this is a community that would otherwise be, that is categorized as a backward caste and a backward community. The occupation of fishing was a caste-based occupation that they practiced. And essentially, the reason that they were looking, that they continue in it and they have historically practiced it, was also because there was something about the lay of the land itself that made fishing very possible, very available. So, again, if there's someone with a background in geography, perhaps they'll understand this. If you were to look at the Bombay was seven separate islands, right? And the natural formations of those creeks within the city, and the natural formations of those islands allowed for harbor, you know, creation of good harbors. And so fishing was always a very strong livelihood occupation that was practiced, and the Kolis, considered as one of those original inhabitants, were the ones who practiced this historically and continue to, although there are some changes in this, which is what we're going to look at. They continue to stay in their settlements or colonies. You could call them neighborhoods because they just look like urban neighborhoods. Some of them have been unfortunately classified as slums under the urban policies of Mumbai today. But essentially, they dot the coast of Mumbai. There are about 32 of these Koliwadas, as we call them. And this is, as I mentioned, a backward caste. So education levels are fairly low, and this is something that I want to return to sort of come back to this question of why education was so significant for the community. And in social terms, they have been classified as this backward community. So what exactly has happened here is that what we are trying to do is to look at how this community that had such a strong hold over the occupation of fishing, which was also of course marked by caste, which meant as a backward caste, this was a backward caste based occupation. It was not necessarily an occupation that others were drawn into or wanted, were flocking to in any kind of way. How is it that suddenly this practice of fishing has now opened out in a way to allow for new entrants to come in? And what have been the changes, therefore, in the livelihood practices of this community, and their sense of what their work is? Is their work purely caste-based work? Is it a customary idea of work? Has that undergone a change itself? Both for the community itself as well as for other participants, and this is something that has happened over the last few decades. Traditionally, the way fishing was practiced by the Koli community, was that the scale of operations, as we call it, the scale of fishing was very small. This is not to suggest that you are only fishing enough for subsistence, because as a community that is living off your fishing, you're not going to only consume fish. Right? So they are, of course, generating a surplus in that sense, which is usually brought into the domestic retail market. But the scale of operations is smaller than what it has currently expanded into. And there are all kinds of sort of indicators of how this transformation has happened, starting from the kind of nets that were used in traditional or what we call artisanal fishing, to what is currently used under the catchless transformation in fishing, the size of the boats, the amount of labor you might hire, some of which still continue. So you can see that there's a gender-based division of work, which meant when we're talking about fishing, we typically imagine fishing only in that sort of active sense of, you know, going out to sea and fishing. But that's only one part of that livelihood occupation, really. That was a part that was performed by men from the community who went out to fish. But the women from the community were also involved in work of fishing, which is primarily what we call post-harvest work in fishing. You know, once the fish is brought back to the shore, actually buying that fish, taking it, there's a large fish auction that is held, buying it from there, from those wholesale auctions, taking it to the smaller domestic markets, or the curing of fish, the drying of fish, and selling those in months where you don't go out to fish. These are all primarily activities that were done by women. And we'll come back to this question a little later, because I'm obviously interested in what was happening to this aspect of labor under the change that took place. We had what we call a small class of owner workers, right? What that meant was essentially when men went out to fish, say you would have one person who owned a boat and owned the net and the other implements that you would use in the act of fishing, and you shared the work with, say, 4 to 5 other people. But the owner of the boat, the owner of the implements, also participated in the labor, right? So they classified themselves as such, as owner workers, as being both someone who owned the means of production, so to say, but also participated in the work, really. And they earned an income as a share of what was caught, right? So there was a share that was divided equally from the sale of that fish, with the owner worker taking two parts instead of a single part that a worker would receive. But since it was women who were buying the fish off at the auctions, what was very interesting at an earlier time when we still had a large-scale traditional fishing in practice is that actually women control the household finances, right? Right. So I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with Mumbai. Right, but in Mumbai there's also this popular idea of the Koli fisherwoman. She's a very present public sort of figure, right? And if you've seen those Mario Miranda sketches, etc., there are always the Koli fisherwoman present there. And of course it's because she's in public space, she's the one selling and vending fish, etc. But it's also because the Koli woman is always associated as being a very assertive figure, right? And in some sense, we can say that sense of assertion, the sense of confidence also comes from the fact that women in this traditional occupation as it stood, held a very strong and a very central place, right? And you can see that by the fact that household income was pretty much controlled by women. So there's an old work, there's a 1953 book that is done on the Koli fishing community in Mumbai again, which actually shows you the continuing presence of household finances being controlled by women, and then the sort of social chain, the social relations that it produces of more or less sort of equitable relations between men and women within the community, right? But all of this, on the economic front of economic relations of production, social relations between the genders, etc., all of this starts undergoing a change when we start seeing a transformation of fishing from the small scale to a much larger scale, right? That means there was an intense sort of attention from the state, and this was not just the state in independent India. So right from the colonial period onwards, we had the notion that there should be some kind of transformation in the fisheries. It was simply seen as being too unproductive, too inefficient at the scale at which it operated. And so the idea was, let's expand this out, right? The colonial state actually justified or legitimized this idea in two ways. The point of intervention came right after the Bengal famine. So there was a notion that, the colony ought to have a secure food supply, and fish was seen as a good resource in that sense. So if you could expand out the scale of production, you could ensure a supply of protein to your population, which could come in handy during times like this. But more interestingly, fish was also seen as a site of revenue generation, right? The colonial state was just about tapping into the possibilities that lay with what could happen if you were to introduce capitalist change into the fisheries. And at this point of time, we see both the Madras and Bombay presidency as running these short experiments. It's very interesting if you actually go to the archives, you can see a whole degree of communication between these two presidencies, and they had fisheries bureaus. They appointed directors to these bureaus, and they were actually interested in looking at what was the kind of technology that ought to be introduced, where should mechanization come in, at what level, how should it be done, and there's great sort of work that has been done on this for the Madras fisheries, which I can point you out to if you're interested. But essentially, the idea sort of set in place that an expansion was necessary. That fishing as it was practiced by this community, and of course this casteist notion was strongly at play even with the colonial state, that this was a backward caste that was doing it, because it was socially and economically backward, and they didn't seem to, the colonial state attributed and said that this caste doesn't seem to have the foresight in what they could actually do if they set their minds to it, without of course realizing what the scale of this transformation actually entails. But nevertheless, the colonial state decides, let me take over this sort of project, and begins on an experimental basis to introduce mechanization and technology, shift them out from these primitive, backward technological modes onto new, more exciting ways. And so this is a period when we start seeing, for instance, the introduction of small-scale motors. Gradually this expands out in the 1940s to the introduction of trawlers in fishing. I don't know, again, if you're familiar with this, a trawler is essentially a boat that emerged during the World War, right? It used to trawl the seabed for mines. So that's where that technology was first adopted. But then it's brought into the fisheries because they realized that essentially, if you were to set a net in place over there, while it trawls the seabed, you would also be picking up a large amount of fish on the way. And so very soon, post the war, from trawling as being used for mining operations, it's brought in completely into the fisheries for use, and we start seeing a slow transformation of what was once a livelihood occupation and a caste-based occupation turn into some kind of modern industrial enterprise that could draw in more people, that could become a site for generating profits, that could be a site for generating revenue, right? The Bombay Presidency, as I've indicated, they had some failed investments. So they began in the 1914, they had a few failed experiments, but they never sort of gave up on the idea. So the tenacity of that idea itself is indicative that they thought there was some real potential here, right? So it went back and forth in that, and there was a period of lull. It didn't really pick up quite as strongly as it does in the post-independent period. In India, from 1953 onwards, the state basically also came alive to the question, and it's very interesting again to see the same kind of legitimacy and justification being sought, that this would both ensure food supply as well as revenue generation, and so it was worthy of the state's attention, worthy of the investment in technology that would be needed. So in partnership, they sought to begin and introduce this new mechanization. They brought in trawlers, they brought in new kinds of nets, all of which would actually lead to surplus, an expanded scale of surplus production, right? But nothing really clicked until the 1960s. What happened in the 1960s is that not so much from the coast of Maharashtra, but actually from the coast of southern India, there was a discovery of the waters in this in the southern zone as being quite rich in shrimps or prawns, right? Until then, actually, shrimps or prawns in the Indian domestic fish market didn't have much value. Right, so people actually used it as, even used to throw it as waste if they caught it alongside other fish, or would use it as fertilizers. So it was quite common for prawns to be used as fertilizers. But then there was a discovery that there is an exciting export market which is quite interested in prawns and shrimps as a commodity. Right, so this happens in the 1960s. And they export, so many of these small companies that are operating on mechanized, with mechanized boats, begin exporting prawns and shrimps to many countries. The US in particular was one major receiver of these sort of exports. And that is when we say that, you know, the discovery of this market leads to what we call the pink revolution. Right? Pink for the color of shrimp and prawns, if you've seen them. Right? And that really begins a large-scale transformation in the fisheries as a whole. So once there's a realization that this mechanization can actually lead to great revenue generation, if done on a much more expanded scale, you make it, you expand that scale to make those exports viable, then it was going to yield the revenue and the results that were being sought for so many decades earlier. And that's when the government enters in a very concerted manner. They begin by introducing subsidized technology, they advance loans through fisher cooperatives, looking to really, from the bottom up as they see it, transform fishing as an occupation as a whole. And they are trying to do it by keeping the community in the forefront. So for instance, in the state of Maharashtra, you had, if you were to avail of new mechanized technology, you had to form a small cooperative of 7 fishermen, and you were to then seek a loan from the fisheries department, and you were to put down a small down payment of your own, but the government would heavily subsidize the mechanized technology that you could actually use, and so you could also partake in this new investment. But more critically, what it did was that the link between the caste or the community and that occupation, that comes to be sort of strained or severed under this kind of condition. Because what really happens is that the state also opens the deep seas as a, for investment. They start inviting companies to participate in deep sea fishing and to start exporting the fish out from here. So really from the idea of the seas as a common, you go to an idea of the seas as a source of great revenue generation or great capital accumulation, a new market that could be exploited. And as soon as this market opens up, you also find all kinds of new entrants coming into this occupation, right? So we find capitalists coming from all kinds of castes, all kinds of communities in India, looking to make a mark in the fisheries as well. And for the community itself, this is a very major disruption to have occurred, right? The question of what happens under the severing of this link is very interesting, because what I'm arguing essentially is that the way in which men's work came to be transformed under these conditions, and the way in which women's work comes to be transformed, or the lack of transformation, as I will argue, is what allows us to understand why and how they participate in the kind of labor and political movements in the city of Mumbai. Right? As I defined it, primarily when all this change is happening, the change is directed at mechanization, change is directed at the technology used for fishing. Right? On the other hand, we had what we call the women's work in the fisheries, which, as I mentioned before, was post-harvest work. It's not work that took place on the site of the boat itself or in the act of fishing itself. It was something that happened after one had come back from fishing. Right? And what started happening with the capitalist transformation in the fisheries was that there was, of course, a sort of blindness of insight, if you may call it, or a willful ignorance of what was happening with women's work in the fisheries, because essentially no technology was introduced into women's work in the fisheries, right? So the same kind of, if you were to go back again to the archives and see how did women process fish, for instance, in the early, 19th century or 20th century, and how do they do it now? There's very little progression in terms of the technology that has been introduced into this, right? So women in the fisheries are complaining about how they find that there has been no intervention, technologically speaking, from the state side into their work, right? So they are still relying on old methods of doing it. If there are new technology available, they don't find access to subsidies from the state to actually ease their access to this kind of technology. And so they, at the end of it, they say that very little in terms of the nature of work itself for them transformed under this so-called massive capitalist transformation that was supposed to really engage fisheries at all its levels. The second major sort of intervention they did, as I said, was that it opened up the fisheries as a market where many kinds of new entrants were coming in. One of the big entrants encouraged heavily by the Indian state was, of course, export companies that were going to enter fisheries and take on the mantle of exporting fish to other countries. Now, what this did was really affect women's work in the fisheries. As I mentioned before, women were the ones who were engaged in the vending and retailing of fish in domestic markets. Right? They used to have sort of relations with auctioneers when the fish would actually come into these wholesale markets. Typically, they were operating on credit because this is not, so they would buy fish on credit, go sell it in a domestic market somewhere and come back and pay for that fish later. But all of this slowly started changing when you have export companies come in. Right? Because what export companies were able to do was that they had any cash in hand. Not just that, they were able to actually hire or take on entire boats and sort of set up bargains and deals in advance. So before a boat even went out to sea, they had already promised their catch to a particular buyer, right? And the women felt that they were being edged out or pushed out of the market because of this. Particularly because of the problem that they simply did not have access to that credit anymore. They simply could not, they weren't operating on a level playing field with these large export companies anymore. So women started feeling the brunt of this. They also realized, this is not specific to the case of women's work in the fisheries that you find migrant men into, but this has been the major contestation of women within the fisheries, protesting the fact that migrant men have entered the fisheries. Right? That means once the scale of operations transforms, you have bigger boats going out into the sea, you have more boats going out into the sea, you do need more. You do need more labor, right? And this labor was now increasingly coming in not just from local Koli men. As we've discussed before, this was typically a customary practice. You were schooled in the ways of fishing through your community life, right? So prior to the capitalist transformation, if you had to go out fishing, you needed to know how to navigate the boat, right? You needed to know how to read the stars. You needed to know where exactly to go. You needed to know where exactly to go if you were to find particular kinds of fish. You needed to know what kinds of nets to lay out. Right? But the introduction of technology does something remarkable. It actually brings in, we always associate technology with scaling and scaling up, right? But what was happening here was actually a de-scaling. Because you just needed to know how to operate the technology on the board. which would navigate for you. You had sonars, for instance, which would tell you exactly where you could find fish. There was no different kinds of nets. You had the one single kind of net that would just scoop up everything that it could find, right? And this kind of descaling had meant that it was to work as labor on a boat. To work as labor on a boat, you no longer needed to be Koli, right? Which was something that was pretty essential earlier, right? But now you can actually, you could have migrated and actually met many migrant laborers who were actually coming in from landlocked districts, landlocked states, never having gone out to sea, never having even seen a sea before, until they suddenly land in Mumbai and get hired as, you know, your footloose, informal labor. They just, one fishing season, they've been hired and they go out to sea. And unfortunately, sometimes until they were out in sea, they didn't realize how violently sick they could get, for instance, right? Doing this kind of work, because if you felt seasick, it was going to pose real difficulties. But the point is that what this transformation did was that it opened up the market, not just in the sense of the investors or the capitalists who were entering the market, but it also opened up the labor market within the fishing, so that you had a lot of migrant men participating in fishing, right? But on the other side of it, what it also did was that it brought in a lot of migrant men who are now looking to enter fish retail, right? And this was, as we know, traditionally within the community, there's a very strong divide. The men go out to fish, women are the ones who go out and sell fish, right? But now migrant men started coming and also buying fish from the same auctions where these women were also operating, where your large-scale export companies are also operating, buying smaller amounts of fish. And instead of basing themselves out of fish markets like the women, Koli women do, they would actually go door to door. Typically, this would be in low-income neighborhoods, for instance, slum neighborhoods. They would go door to door selling fish, and they sell fish at much lower rates, women would argue. And therefore, these Koli women were contesting that on the one hand, they were being pushed out by these export companies that were operating. On the other hand, they were being edged out by migrant men who were also taking over their work, right? So they felt a loss on two ends. They felt that they were both being marginalized, because as a Koli, you were not being able to fish anymore. And this was very, or not being associated with fishing anymore, right, in the case of women. And this was a very essential part of that Koli identity. The link with fishing was something that was, as I mentioned, historically situated. It's present in the popular discourse of that city itself. And it was definitely a very central part of the community's understanding of who they were. And so they felt that as Kolis, they were suffering on that front, that they were being pushed out of what was once their occupation. And on the other hand, they were also arguing that their work, women's work, was also not being secured in any kind of way, and that they were being edged out by migrant men from what was their domain of work, right? And so what we essentially see is that it was Koli women who were coming out and contesting and making demands that fishing be reclassified in some sense as an activity that would only be practiced by traditional fishing communities. Right? This has also contributed, and I mean certainly not the case only in Mumbai, but all over the coasts of India, in numerous locations, because of this kind of transformation, the disruptions in traditional livelihoods it's caused, we actually have the presence of a national fish workers movement today, right, under the banner of the National Fish Workers Forum. And one of the demands that they have been consistently making is this, which is to say that fishing should be an activity that lies within the domain of traditional fishing communities, right? And when they say traditional fishing communities, they very much have in mind communities like the Kolis themselves, right? But what was happening was that on the streets of Mumbai, Koli women were coming out and agitating and saying precisely this, but their ire was not directed at the state for, say, opening up the fisheries and allowing so many people to enter. Instead, their ire went to the migrant men, right? And there were, you know, sometimes in even very violent protests. So in 2004, for instance, this is all considered, I mean, it was reported, but it's still seen as fairly hush-hush, the fact that Koli women were actually beating up migrant men, right? They were physically stopping them from going into these wholesale markets, buying fish, or trying to go and sell fish anywhere. They were very, very violently protesting them. And as a result, many of them have police cases that have been sort of slapped on them, and they're still fighting these cases out. But they have become the face of this contestation in Mumbai, right? And the contestation in Mumbai has become about the fact that migrants are coming and taking over the work in the fisheries, right? Now, if we are familiar with urban politics and urban contestation, this is something we know is being happening. The contestation between the locals and the migrants, right? The assumption that locals are losing their jobs to migrants who are coming in. And particularly in Mumbai, this is a politics that has been popular from the 1960s onwards. So the Shiv Sena has played a very strong role in sort of fanning this kind of hostility towards migrants. And it, not surprisingly, therefore, if you the Koli women's discourse on their job loss, their livelihood destruction, has aligned very closely with how the Shiv Sena and later the Maharashtra Navnirman Sena has also been making arguments and claims about the loss of jobs and livelihoods because of the entry of migrants, right? So, for instance, Koli women are not protesting any kind of migrant who is taking away their work. They are focused on the North Indian migrant, as they see it, who is the main cause for hostility, right? And this is very clearly, it aligns with what the Shiv Sena's own shifts have been. Because in the 60s, the Shiv Sena was against the South Indian migrant, right? But come 90s, 2000, that has become the North Indian migrant, the figure of the North Indian migrant. So, and the entire discourse of the Sena on sons of the soil, you know, the nativist kind of discourse has also found hold over here. So there has been that sort of alignment at work. This is not to suggest that what is happening to Koli women does not, you know, require some kind of consideration or attention, because there is very serious economic and social issues at stake here, right? There has been a loss of livelihood practice, both by men and women, right? But they are reacting to it very differently, and this is what we want to try and understand. We know that there is a level of dispossession at work here, right? That through this kind of capitalist transformation at work, men within the fisheries have also been losing jobs. So you cannot, it's no longer sustainable to practice small-scale fishing. So we find that a lot of those who used to work on smaller boats have found this simply unsustainable and moved to either become labor on the larger boats or have moved out of fishing completely and picked up other jobs in the cities. Right? Women are continuing in fishing, and this is precisely what I want to examine. Why are they continuing in the face of this? But they're continuing in the face of odds. You know, the stacks are raised against them. What this transformation has also done is it has brought in an ecological question, which is that the scale is so expanded that we're actually reaching situations where, and you know, the state of Kerala has actually had this once, where you have a state of fish famine, as we call it. You've just fished so much, you've overfished the waters, that there's simply nothing left, right? And for women whose income and livelihood depends on actually procuring fish, if there's actually nothing coming into the markets to buy, they're really going to be left with nothing to do, right? There's also been a question of the gentrification of market spaces from which the Koli women operated. I just want to flag that off as one of those, again, points around urban politics that has particularly hit Koli women, because in the larger discourse of urban renewal in the city of Mumbai, what has come under specific attention has been your older markets. And typically a lot of these older markets were fish markets to begin with, right? And Koli women are now suggesting that while one has a livelihood is facing this sort of disruption, their traditional spaces, their domain of work as they saw it, which was the fish market, also faces this problem where they're constantly being pushed out, because in a gentrified market, nobody wants a Koli fisherman, right? Even if that might be your image of what Bombay's bustling markets and cities looks like, a gentrified market looks like a mall, and there is no place for a Koli fisherman in that space, right? What you want, therefore, is a more cleaner, a more sanitized image of fish market, and this is something to which Koli women may not actually have access. Right? So the dispossession is sharp, and the dispossession is felt very acutely by both men and women. But the problem has been that there seems to be this kind of differential response. Now, I argue that this differential response is also happening because of the fact that education between men and women have taken such different kind of directions. Right? What that has brought in has been that over a period of time, particularly from the early 20th century onwards, if one looks at archival work, you've seen that there has been a consistent demand from the community, classified as they are as a backward class. There has been a demand that in order to gain mobility, they require education, right? So there has been intervention from both the colonial state as well as the independent Indian state to push education amongst the community. But the takers of this education, or the receivers of this education, have been men from the community, right? And resultantly, with improving their own education levels, men have been able to move out of fishing and move to other kinds of jobs. Typically, they're looking to join formal work, right? So when I was doing this, ethnography, when I was speaking to young Koli men, I was talking to young parents and asking them, what they see as a future for their children. Almost everyone uniformly said, we don't want to go out and do this like manual labor of fishing anymore, right? But that's not an idea of a good life. The good life is a formal job, right? And that's a job that you get with education. So they would always use this phrase, they would say 9-to-5 jobs, right? That's what we want. That's a sign that you have gained mobility in life, right? And that is precisely being what those who have been educated, or those who have been able to secure higher levels of education amongst the Koli community, have been looking to move out into these formal jobs. Where they have not been able to secure those formal jobs, they have secured other informal work, right? So for instance, a lot of young Koli men who don't find work on small scale boats or don't end up working on the trawlers, for instance, will do other kinds of work. They become lifeguards. You have a lot of water sports companies that operate from Bombay. Again, if you've seen in South Bombay, for instance, you have a lot of these water sports companies. Your lifeguards there, your water ski riders there, they're all men coming from the neighboring Kolivadas, right? So they have been able to find work outside of the community, or the traditional work of the community in some kind of way, right? And this, there's a very neat sort of match in this. If you see over here, I'm just trying to sort of point that out, that if you look at what the education levels are and you were to try and compare it to the kind of work they find, you will notice that with higher education levels they are moving out. So there's a, for instance, those who are completing secondary education are moving out and finding work. Those who completed graduation are finding work outside the fishery. So there's a very strong, even though the community identity is still so deeply tied to the notion of fishing, there is still a central idea of mobility that the community operates with, which is that mobility cannot be found, social mobility, occupational mobility can't be found within fishing anymore. You have to find better forms of work. And a better form of work, unless you turn into the new fisher capitalist as we have it today under this transformed fisheries, is not going to happen within the fisheries, but outside of it, right? So what has actually happened with women is that their education levels have not risen at quite the same level as men. So in spite of the fact that women have also, decade after decade, the levels of education or the number of women securing education has gone up, it has simply not matched or corresponded with the kind of education levels that men are able to receive, right? And resultantly what we find therefore is that while Koli men are able to find a way out of the fisheries, Koli women remain back in the fisheries, because this is what this is all that they seemingly have access to and all that they are familiar with, right? And so the idea of fighting to secure your hold over what is your occupation becomes even more significant an issue. Since if you lose this, you literally have nothing to fall back on, right? It's not as though the education levels have risen to an extent to allow for accessing work outside of the fisheries to that extent, right? And so therefore, women have really become, as I mentioned, they have become that sort of front line on this war about who can fish and who should fish. So even though the men would argue that yes, we do want fishing to remain within the community, it's not that they don't correspond with this, their idea of what that work should be has undergone a transformation. They now would argue that in this transformed fisheries, it's good if I can become that person who owns the boat. And if you remember in the beginning, I said we had what we call owner workers, right? They owned it, but they also went out and worked on it. But that's no longer an idea that the Koli man holds on to, right? To do well as a Koli fisher now actually means that you can be a good Koli fisher businessman, as they see it, where you command capital, you have a large trawler, you send out your trawler to sea, and this actually takes a lot of money to run, right? So for a single trip of a trawler, which will typically go out into sea for like say 10 days or so, you need a running cost of typically upwards of like 15 to 20 lakhs, right? So that's a lot of, 5 minutes? That's a lot of money to hold, right? But the idea of that work identity, or that identity as a community into work, has now gone from the days of saying I can go out to the sea and I know how to operate the seas, and it has become more about how I can actually run this as a successful business, right? So I actually met this man whose family had gone away from fishing a long time back, and they used to run this very successful hotel and bar in Mumbai, but he now wants to return to what he called his described it himself as his traditional occupation of fishing, but he's not imagining this in the sense of the small scale of fishing that he wanted to return to, but now as this capitalist who can now, you know, own three trawlers and send those out to sea and actually participate in this work, right? But in this entire scheme, women's work has been ignored. Women's work has faced the brunt of this transformation with no changes, no substantial changes in their education level, and certainly no aid by the state in trying to modernize, mechanize, introduce new technology, or be able to participate in this newly transformed fisheries in any kind of significant way. And so this kind of transformation for women, which has left them at the worst end of this dispossession, has obviously put them in this very troublesome position where there is a need to identify what has gone wrong, right? And in that scheme of trying to look at what has gone wrong, the migrant has become a very clear target, right? And the hostility that can be built up in an already existing discourse that is present within the city of Bombay, which can be directed against this migrant, that context is already present, right? And so they have strongly sort of participated in and politicized the question of migrants entering fishing, because they see it as a real struggle on the question of what is a community's work. And therefore their interpretation of a demand of fishing going for traditional communities doesn't come from the idea of saying that traditional communities practice fishing in a more ecologically sensitive way, and that there should be a retreat into, say, smaller scale fishing, or that we should try and limit the entry of large capital, which is how the National Fishworkers Forum tries to conceive of it. But rather, on the streets of Bombay, the way in which this demand is being interpreted is a pitched battle between the migrant and the North Indian migrant and the Koli woman. And who wins this battle is seen as being decisive for what is going to happen to fishing and what is going to happen to the Koli community as a whole, right? So in terms of when you're looking at, I began by saying, you know, this bears consideration for how we think about our policies. One of the problems that this has raised, for instance, is that how do we think about a policy around the question of fishing, right? Because this has been the consistent demand of the NFF, that the state ought to formulate a policy on fishing, that the state ought to consider this much in the lines of how you had the Forest Rights Act that did secure conditions for communities that were like that had their livelihood closely tied into those resources. The state should pay similar attention here. And while it should, and the state ought to come up, there is a draft act in place, what it also would need to do therefore is to try and pay some consideration to how their own gender blindness may have produced the circumstances under which a deeply economic question also gets turned into a sort of social battle on lines of ethnicity and on lines of regionality. So that is something that would require further consideration from the part of both the movement as well, which is working with fishing communities, but also on the part of the state in terms of how it actually responds to these claims that are being made by the fishing community. So I think with that, I'll just wrap it up. I had a little bit more than I think.
Basic, so I think that women
that's a good question. Thank you for that. One is, of course, our familiar reason of patriarchy as it operates. So, with limited resources, as I mentioned, this is an economically backward community. So, it wasn't as if there were a lot household finances. If they were to be split between educating your children, the preference was going to male children over women. Interestingly, what I saw in more in the younger age group was actually not that, for instance, girls would not be sent to school, but there the gender differential would play out in terms of the medium of education. So boys, for instance, would get sent to English medium schools because those were seen as leading to, you know, better kinds of jobs later, whereas girls would be sent to your Marathi medium schools. That's one reason. The other was that because, linked to this itself, because of the fact that you were sort of weighing the question about who to educate and how to educate, young girls were being inducted into the practice of fish vending quite early on. Right, so the idea of letting go of schooling was fairly acceptable, and that used to be earlier quite acceptable for young men as well, which is why as a whole to the community the levels were low. But particularly with these sort of trying circumstances, I did mention that the market spaces and how those were transforming. Market spaces is very interesting and also part, in the community's idea, the market space is also handed down, almost like a property from woman to woman, right? So if you needed to boost household finances, you needed to bring in one more person to actually participate in that. You could hand over your market space to your young daughter or daughter-in-law, or, you know, whatever the case might be, and you could try and move out somewhere else to try and sell more fish, or you could try and take off two positions in a market vis-a-vis the one that you had. So there was both something about the way in which the livelihood was being practiced, which led to those low levels of education. But the gender differential also does come from the fact that competing resources, they felt it was better to educate the boys who would perhaps do better than the girls. Yeah.
Basically, in that community, when did the end of labor work? If you require any education level, since women did the more intellectual work, wasn't it considered that I want to educate women and make it for small scale work a possible large scale?
It's interesting that you're posing that as the division between physical work and intellectual work. I don't think the community conceives it on those lines, right? So then both were fairly important parts. And fishing only made sense of the whole if both those elements came together. It wasn't going to be sufficient if you just fished. It wasn't going to be sufficient if you just went on the market. You actually had to have something of both. But I think the assumption was that handling finances was not seen as something that you needed to go to school to pick up on. That there was something you could get schooled in at home itself, right? You would accompany your mother or grandmother to the fish market and you would pick that up. So you didn't require a school education to do well at that. And you could be a fairly successful fisherwoman. You needed other kinds of skills. You needed marketing skills, you know, social skills. You actually had to, have steady customers who came to you for like decades on end. And those were not skills necessarily that literacy or, you know, was going to provide you. So therefore, it was not conceived of as being important to educate the girls. With the boys, what was happening was that even with the boys, as I mentioned earlier, particularly when they had small scale fishing, they were dropping out of education quite early on. Right? So if you actually, like, I don't have that with me right now, but if we look at the figures of other age cohorts, particularly the older age cohorts, you notice that education levels even for men were very, very low. But what was happening over a period of time was that they were responding to the changes that were taking place in the fishery. They could either go down the path of becoming this the businessman in fisheries via the state aid and the state loans that were coming in, or you were seeing the possibilities of mobility aligned somewhere else. So they were responding to those changes quite quickly, and they figured it was better to gain an education to gain your formal employment. So that's the reason why men were able to direct that. And again, I think it ties into that. Like, if you had a limited amount of money and you had a son and a daughter, you chose to go with the son, to invest in the son, because that's how you saw the family progressing. Yeah.
Why can't the Koli women be trained to, you know, be a part of the processing of fish in the companies that have come up there? So if they can't fish, they could be a part of the processing units that the companies have set up for the fish.
Yeah. Okay.
So are they taking up those jobs or?
No, so again, actually those jobs that operate the fish processing jobs are high, like they are very, very labor intensive jobs. They are part of the informal sector of this formal enterprise of the export company. So typically, export companies hire migrants, both men and women, to do that work. They pay very low wages, we work very, very long hours in quite terrible working conditions. And so it's not something that would necessarily pay better than what the Koli fisherwoman is already doing. But I think the demand could be made as to why aren't, within the existing work that women are doing, why aren't we introducing better modes there? So, for instance, the state-run fisheries institutes as well, right? In addition to the kind of loans and subsidies they give, they also provide training modules, right? And if as a man you were to enroll in that for a training module, you would automatically be trained in going out to fish in a modern boat. But if as a woman you were to enroll, you would be again diverted back into the work of curing fish, processing fish, doing all of that. For which now there is some new technology. So we have, for instance, the introduction of like solar dryers for fish, right? Which can, otherwise you were drying fish by just hanging it out on the line and you wait for the sun to do its job and it would take any time. But now you do have some kind of introduction of technology, how to convert those into small snacks and market those snacks and sell them. This is on the state's agenda. But I think the argument here is, why is the state continuing to perpetuate a gender divide when it needn't be like that, right? If we are particularly saying that the work on the of fishing, if you're not on a boat particularly, doesn't really involve any hard labor. This is the association of the state, right? That hard labor can only be performed by men. So therefore only men should do this kind of work. But if this is not even the case, even if we were to follow its own problematic logic, if that does not stand, then what is the need to not do this? So actually there are Kolis themselves who are saying this, that up to, they say fishing to business ki tarah chalta hai, toh kya hai, aurat bhi kar sakti, aadmi bhi kar sakta hai, right? But where is the training, where is the support, where is the aid, where is the loans coming for women to actually participate in this kind of work? So neither is it coming for them to enter as these capitalists, if that's what the state wants, neither is it coming on their end of the work. So instead, they are just trapped in this sort of finite market with these competing sort of sources. So fish processing is primarily migrant activity, and by which we mean it's exploitative work, it's highly exploitative work. Yeah?
What were the local authorities' reactions when migrants entered the fisheries for the first time, and why did they allow this?
See, they don't see it, first of all, I should tell you that there's no documentation of when was the first movement migrants happened. The interesting thing is also that it's not necessarily new. Migration into fisheries has always happened, okay? It's happened from neighboring districts. So for instance, we're looking at Mumbai district from Ratnagiri, which is another coastal district in Maharashtra, you had migrants coming into the fishery. We have migrants from Andhra, Orissa, everywhere. Like, they would perhaps come for a few seasons and then go back. They were not responding to it as a problem because it was not conceived of as a problem. And neither do Koli men necessarily see it as a problem. Koli men would view it as a problem if migrants can suddenly start owning boats. But right now migrants only come in as labor, right? Which means the figure of authority is still the Koli man, or the Koli in that sense, which is more central to them. And therefore they are comfortable with it. It is the women who see this as a problem. And the way in which the state responded, because as I mentioned, it became violent, right? The state did respond, and many of these women were arrested and cases were put. And so they talk about how they thought they had the support. See, the Bombay municipality was Shiv Sena, the local cooperator where this was happening was Sena. So they thought they had that party support, but when the cases got snapped, they realized, because the central government was not a, obviously not a Sena ally government, it was a Congress government at that time, and so they felt that kind of pressure come. So there are many kinds of dynamics, political dynamics at work here. So there was definitely pressure from the central government to quash any kind of flare-ups like this, right? Because you can't have this ethnic kind of riot breakout now between the North Indians and the local Maharashtrians. But if you were to talk to people in the fisheries board, etc., they show empathy for the case of the Kolis, because they also work with the idea that yes, this is their work.
And nobody else should come. Thank you. There seems to be some apparent contradiction between the workers, the fish workers union demand, and
yeah.
Koli, especially the Koli's
yeah.
demand. Not demand so much, but the aspirations. It both seems to be contradictory, right?
Yes.
So even the same similar thing is observed from situation assessment survey. Previous, about 10 years back, they asked farmers whether you want to continue with farming. Almost 50% of them said we don't want to continue.
Mm.
Even the drudgery that is involved, even this fishing is fishing takes place at a small scale, psychologically conducive way. The drudgery that is drudgery involved in fishing compared to any other profession. Right? So I think it makes anybody to move out of it, whether this position takes place or not.
Yeah.
So making a demand which is on par with Forest Right Act doesn't seem to be very practical in that sense.
Yeah, I agree actually, and I think this is a contradiction that the National Fish Workers Forum themselves are sort of trying to resolve. It also comes from the fact that the Fish Workers Forum has, prior to 1989, they had one strand of argument which was on the not on an ecological line, but on a very clear line of the working class movement and what had to be done, right? And they were trying to suggest that fishing communities were largely, when they were operating on a smaller scale, constituted not your capitalist class, for instance, and that the entry of large capital was causing impoverishment, pauperization of this community. And if you would talk to the senior NFF activists, for instance, they still argue it like this. They say large capital has to be kept out. That is why we are making these demands, right? But on the ground, post 1989, what happened is that they took on a stand where they said this is not about capitalism. This is about ecology, right? And in an ecological sense, it's better to keep this at a small scale, and that's why we're making the argument, because traditional communities have the traditional knowledge required to participate in this in an ecological fashion. But you're absolutely right in that the community is not, while this is of course happening in consonance to the community, in different places this is getting articulated very differently. So in Mumbai itself, I've met many trawler owners, pursing net owners, and these are the most ecologically destructive kind of technology we have, who would say, yes, it's very tragic, the ecological destruction this is causing, but see no problem with them doing it because they see it as necessary for their survival. Everyone is sort of pushing them in this direction, and obviously it moves away from the drudgery of the world that, why would you continue in arduous labor when you have the option to sort of move out? So there are many contradictions that are running into one another. So that's why the crafting of the policy, I mean, perhaps is one of the reasons why it's stuck, the draft act is stuck as it is. There were initially some idea of drawing comparisons to the Forest Rights Act. When the act comes about, then the problem has also been that it's too similar to the Forest Rights Act. So the consideration is that, look, there is not even a sense of how the seas are different from the forest, right? So one of the demands, for instance, of the fisheries movement has consistently been to say, please give us a separate Ministry of Fisheries, right? Because otherwise it comes under agriculture and animal husbandry. There's no understanding of what the fisheries as requires, what kind of policies it requires, what kind of thinking it requires. So there are many lines of contestation emerging, and that is precisely why I think one of the reasons why this has transformed into this kind of ethnic conflict that is playing out, because the fundamental contradictions have not been resolved, neither within the movements or by the community themselves.
All right, please join me with your questions. I'd like to call upon Dr. Maya Vinay to please, as a token of our gratitude, to please hand over.